Hey folks, Dagan here from PMTVUK, and today we have the absolute pleasure of chatting to John Browne from Monuments. Halfway through their European tour, we'll be checking out his live guitar rig, his guitars, his amplifiers. It's going to be awesome. And it just so happens that he has a brand new signature Schecter guitar. Let's go check it out. Brown, thank you so much for joining me here today.
Thanks, mate. How are you?
I'm very good, mate. How's the tour going? You're 9 days into quite a mammoth tour.
I'm knackered already. Yeah, I am.
Is everything going smooth though, man? Is it good?
It's really, really good. Like, Leprous are an amazing band. The drummer is phenomenal, excuse my language. And yeah, it's been big shows, loads of crowds.
Yeah, I mean, we'll just say your soundcheck. And speaking of riffs, man, even soundcheck, you give that the brand new Schecter, we're going to talk about shortly. And we spoke about outside about how you're quite a dynamic player, you play hard and you play light.
Yeah.
You wouldn't joke when you say you play hard, man. I mean, you're known as like a riff lord.
Yeah, I just.
Jesus Christ, poor Schecter.
I just copied James Hetfield, just like, you know, and I hit as hard as I can, you know. Like, mainly that reference to like Battery Live in 89. If you see that. Him playing in that and he's singing while doing that, and I'm just like, dude, you win. You've got it.
It was absolutely killer, mate. It's going to be one hell of a show tonight, but let's get straight into it with your wonderful new Schecter guitars.
Yes, perfect. So we've got these three over here.
You wouldn't mind grabbing
them, yeah.
Yeah. This is the first the first tour with these new models, isn't it?
Yeah, it is, yeah. So this is my new six-string signature TAO. Mm-hmm. I think that's how it's pronounced. I liked the word and didn't research how to say it. So this is Ash Body, Flame Maple Veneer, signature pickups, a Chaos Breaker in the neck, and the Colossus in the bridge.
And those are Schecter
USA pickups.
USA pickups.
Awenge, and I believe that this is Paduk. Mm-hmm. Neck, five-piece, hip-shot bridge, hip-shot open gear tuners.
Yeah. And I've just got that access heel as well is ridiculous.
Yeah, it's...
To get the upper access to the fret is crazy.
And then this as well, this cutaway for anyone that reaches the 24th fret, which I rarely do. But yeah, it's a really solid guitar. It sounds great, plays great, really snappy, loads of attack, which is what I want, and the stainless steel frets as well. So hopefully I never have to change them on tour.
Yeah, for sure, man. I mean, with this guitar as well, Schecter are known for making great guitars out the box, but they're also well-renowned for their custom shop and whatnot.
Yep.
Are these the ones you can buy off the shelf?
Let's just take this
off. Because a lot of artists, every Schecter artist I speak to, always play the ones you can buy off the shelf.
Crafted in South Korea.
So the ones that you play on stage in front of thousands of folk are the ones that the same ones that folk get in the stores.
Exactly, yeah. This one was actually the final prototype before it was sent off to obviously have the full, you know, production of it. But this is the last prototype, yeah.
Awesome. What's that nifty little leather thing? Is that just for the string noise?
It's just the string noise above, yeah. So I actually do this for recording. I never normally have it on live, but I left it on and I was like, well, if I don't leave it there, I'm going to lose it by the end of this tour.
Yeah.
So it's there because otherwise I'm going to lose it.
Kick ass. Yeah. So again, we'll get into this more in depth away from here, but if you wouldn't mind quickly showing us the 7-string the wonderful C1 hollow body.
The
C1E,
the semi-hollow, yeah. So we'll start with the 7. Obviously, the specs are still exactly the same. Except
so there's no difference between the specs besides the...
7-string and the fact that it's a 27-inch scale.
Yeah. Because still rocking your new Schecter pickups in this.
Chaos Breaker, Colossus.
Awesome.
And the hip shot, obviously, hip shot there. Mm-hmm. Single tone can obviously pull up and push down for a single coil and a three-way switch. Yeah, exactly the same. And I put these aftermarket DiMaggio clip lock straps so I can change guitar easily when I'm on stage.
Yeah.
So the C1 is a stock model, except I got them to put my pickups in it before they sent it over. But the reason I use this is because it's got the piezo, however you say that word as well, pickup in it. And it means that I don't have to bring an acoustic on tour to play the last song on the new record, which is the Cimmerian. So that's perfect for that, and
One thing I love about Schecter guitars as well is these days they're kind of known for metal guitars, like your wonderful guitars and the rest of them. But they do make great guitars with piezos in. They make semi-hollow body guitars and hot rod strats and stuff.
The Sun Valley series, the Nick Johnston Strat. The Nick Johnston Strat is phenomenal.
It's unbelievable, yeah.
Yeah, it's a really, really good guitar, and it's only €1,200 in Europe. I saw it at Music Store Cologne, so.
It's crazy.
Yeah. Yeah, and it's a great guitar. I mean, I've been using this with that piezo pickup, which sounds great out front.
Yeah.
These pickups sound great. Guitar sounds great. I love semi-hollow guitars. It's a different sort of vibe to it, so.
The fact that you're playing them as well is awesome because you're known for playing some quite wonderful guitars over the years. Yeah. But almost known as boutique guitars, like some of the best of the best. So the fact that Schecter are known for making great guitars anyway, so that's just another tick on their
thing,
how great the quality is and the control. And
it's really, really good. Like, they sent me this like 3 days before I left for this tour. Yeah. Never played it before and immediately got on onto rehearsals and played perfect. It was set up for the tuning I needed. They did all that.
Yeah. Badass, man.
And set up in the same place where everyone else would get it. And as you can see, 9 days in, I'm already damaging the guitar.
Kick ass. If you wouldn't mind grabbing your regular signature six string again to go through some more little things for the... Because I know guys and gals like to get really nitty-gritty with these rig rundowns as well. So you wouldn't mind talking about how you like your guitar set up, the strings you use, and how often you change them and whatnot.
Yep. So right now I'm actually using some D'Addario's. Normally I use DRs. But at the beginning of this tour, I've snapped about two strings on one on this one and one on the other one.
Stop playing so hard, then.
I know, but I have a bunch of sets and I think I might have left them in a precarious place and I think they might be slightly corroded. These ones have got D'Addario on. I'm probably going to go back to the DR in a couple of shows time. Cool. But I normally use DRs. And setup wise, as long as it's playable, I'm normally not that fussy.
Because there's quite a fine line between the intricate stuff that you do and the cleanliness of some of the chuggy stuff. Because you can't really chug with super low action, can you?
No, you can't, no.
Because you'll get that vibration, so I'm guessing there's a fine line.
I mean, it's pretty low at the moment, but I'm not one to really get guitars set up.
Right.
I just kind of leave it and hope for the best. And then about a year after it's been done, I'm like, all right, yeah, it's probably time I got that set up again.
Is that the same with the strings? Do you just play strings until you feel like they need changed, or do you change strings every...
I change every 4 to 5 shows, and that is out of laziness. Anything else, that's it.
The amount of times we've spoke to artists and they change a show play guitar for maybe a few songs and still change it every single night, I'd much rather do what you do, man.
Exactly. Like, I mean, if I had a guitar tech, I'd make them change them every single day. But no, we don't have one of those.
What gauge are you rocking as well?
Just 10 to 46 for Dadgad.
Yeah.
For this one, and then 10 to 52 for the C sharp guitar, which is obviously the piezo one.
Yep.
And then the 7 string is 10 to 46 with a low 60.
Nice one.
Yeah.
What pics do you use? What pics are you rocking at the minute?
Oh, that one.
We'll cut that out. That's nice little nifty.
Yeah, I use a 1mm max grip that I usually have half chewed. As you can see.
Is the chew deliberate?
I just put it in my mouth and forget it's there, and then it's because it's nylon, it just.
The amount of guitar players that are so intricate and intense with the way they play and everything has to be perfect.
Yeah.
And you shred and chug like no man. And you're just like, actually, this pick, it's fine. I still do exactly what I do. Exactly.
I just forget about it. And then I normally forget that I've got more picks in the drawer there, and I just play the one that's in my pocket. Yeah. But awesome. If it's not a max grip, I can't play anymore.
Yeah. So you need that big grip.
Because I've got really slippery fingers. So it's just the max grip or I can't play, basically. Awesome. So.
So it is obviously a live stage and doors are in 20 minutes.
Yeah.
So we've been relegated to backstage. But again, thanks for taking the time to do this again, man.
Anytime.
Well, from the guitars. So DiMaggio clip lock strap. Are you a long time DiMaggio user? Because I'm a big fan of the straps. It's more like a force of habit, isn't it? Like guitars feel right when you're a clip lock strap user for a long time.
And these aren't uncomfortable. You find some guitars, like the big leather straps, and I just don't find them comfortable at all. Whereas this one, I can just unclip it and put a new guitar on in like 5 seconds.
Yeah. So now we're on the strap. Wireless, you're a wireless guy. What kind of wireless are you rocking for this?
Unfortunately, it's out of here right now, but I've got the Sennheiser EWD system, the new one, which has been pretty solid actually.
Yeah.
I need to get the paddle for it so I can have a little bit more range on bigger stages, but so far I haven't had any issues, which is weird to say that.
It's good, everything's going well, man. It's nice and smooth, it's awesome.
Yeah, I'll tell you what though, I never had an issue with the Shure GLXD either, and that was really solid. So I've been pretty lucky with wireless compared to some people, you know.
Yeah, because there's a lot going on your stage, man, so.
Yep, and there's wireless signals everywhere. Like, the opening band have got in-ears, the headliner have got in-ears, wireless guitars, and then we've got wireless in-ears.
What a time to be alive, man.
I know, right? Nikola Tesla would be smiling.
Right, so you're going, I'm guessing the wireless is in the rack with the rest of your lovely gear. Now, you were saying this, you normally rock the Soldano, SLO 30.
Yep.
Why do you love the Soldano so much and why do you kind of gravitate towards that?
It just sounds right. You know, like if you think about all the amps that kind of took their influence from a dual rectifier, a 5150 and a bunch of other amps, it kind of sounds like, you know, when someone writes a song and it's like, oh, that kind of sounds like that artist.
Yeah.
It's kind of like that in the fact that the Soldano is like the one that actually sounds the best out of all of those amps.
Yeah, the Soldano has been tried to be replicated so many times as well, and now they've brought this little 30 out.
Yeah.
And you can absolutely crank it. Yeah. You get that lovely power amp sizzle. It's
and
just
it's still loud.
Fast. Oh yeah, 30 watts does not mean it's loud.
No. Like,
30 watt Soldano is still loud as
I mean, it's 2 6L6s. They've actually had to probably down-tune it.
Oh yeah.
Because obviously it would normally be 50 watts, wouldn't it?
Yeah, I've got a like say as well, thank you for using actual amps and stuff these days, as opposed to fractals. I mean, as convenient, as awesome as they are, fractals, Helix amp modelers and Kempers and stuff, I'll take the world by storm, so thank you for using
that. Well, I actually like mixing them together. So Andy Sneap did this thing with bands in the early 2000s where you use a real amp and then like do a quad track and have a pod or something like that. And it's kind of that, because my signal is actually a quad track signal. So there's actually four lines of guitar.
That's ridiculous. All
slightly out of time with each other. So I use the Helix for direct sound.
Yeah.
And the amp's real sound, blend it in. Switch it on and off depending on the part, depending if it's like more forward, like the Helix adds more mid-range.
So you're not necessarily using it as it in like a four cable method kind of thing. You're kind of using them.
It's actually four separate amps technically, trying to, because obviously we had two guitar players at one point, and it's like, well, if you go down to one guitar from two, it's everyone's gonna be like, oh, it doesn't sound as big as it used to. So I was like, what am I gonna do? TC Mimic came out, and then the Helix modeled it.
The doubler and stuff,
exactly. So it's three instances of the double take, and only one amp is me.
I've just gotta say as well, like with Soundcheck, it sounded absolutely huge.
Thank you.
It was ridiculous. It sounded absolutely fantastic.
Did it sound like more than one?
It sounded like more than one, and it sounded kick-ass.
And there's no rhythm tracks in the laptop. It's all for me. So if I make one mistake, you're gonna hear it four times.
Excellent, excellent, man. Yeah. With the Soldano, though, it's not with us tonight.
Nope.
It's left in Oslo because you've got a crazy tour schedule.
Yeah, I mean, look at all these cases, and we couldn't actually fit it in the trailer with their light production and everything. Yeah. We've actually got a van following us now because it was too much stuff for the trailer, and the bus driver was like, yeah, you are 800 kilograms overweight.
So you're kind of rocking a Bon Jovi and getting like articulated lorries to follow.
That would be amazing if we could do that, but no, unfortunately not that level yet.
So what amp are you rocking tonight?
I've got the Mesa Rectifier preamp for one side, a Synergy SYN2 with the Soldano and Bogner Uberschall modules.
Excellent.
Main one being the Soldano, the Bogner for leads and other alternate sounds. Both into a Mesa 290 into two separate cabs.
Yeah.
So then one slightly delayed from the other. And then
it's such a wonderful setup. Again, I know I'm kind of going on about a bit, but to have a setup like this and not have the fractal and stuff, it's so refreshing.
I mean, like, the fractal's cool and it works on people. It's about how it feels to me, and it just feels wrong.
Yeah.
Like, there's something about it. It doesn't have the same bounce. I've tried it through amps as well, like, you know, like having a power amp with one of those, and it doesn't quite have the dynamic information yet.
Yeah. Well, like I was saying when we first started, the dynamics of your playing going from rock hard to wonderful soft lines, you need that kind of feedback from a reamplifier.
And exactly. I know that in my clean sound, if I hit it slightly harder, it's going to distort a little bit.
Yeah.
But it's not going to do that as well with, you know, one of the other modelers.
Yeah.
I mean, some of them are getting close now, but it's still, it's like when someone programs drums and everything's at 127 MIDI velocity and they're not thought about the dynamics. That's how it feels to me. It's kind of a little bit of lost information. Yeah. So
definitely with the novelty of the Synergy stuff, you've got like the Bogner stuff. Do you change like during songs for certain parts? Do you change tones within the preamps and whatnot?
I haven't gone that far.
Haven't gone that deep. So you're not like rocking the Soldano before a lead. Oh, I'm going to use the Bogner.
Well, I actually use the Bogner for the lead.
You said that before, but like, do you do anything else than that? Or
Channel 3 is like a mixture of clean and also, I don't know if you heard at the end of the first song, it had this octave effect on it, which made my guitar drop down an octave. So that's actually a clean sound with a fuzz and an octave.
Mm-hmm.
Just because it sounds disgusting.
It sounded great. Disgusting, but great.
Yeah, exactly. And so I use the clean sound and then boost the clean sound with a pedal instead.
Yeah.
So that it's more of like that. You know what kind of sound it produces when you have a pedal instead of the amp distortion. It's different and kind
100%,
of filthy with, you know, fuzz. So yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, I like fuzz.
With effects and fuzz and pedals and whatnot, you're running all that kind of stuff through the Helix.
Apart from one pedal.
Apart from one pedal.
Yeah, there's a ground effects gray skull.
Okay.
In the back of the rack, which has the best tracking I've ever heard for an octave pedal. Yeah, it sounds wonderful. I need to get a second one for the other side. But right now I'm using one on one side and it just tracks so well. None of that artifact stuff.
Yeah, you know.
And it's just, and it's got fuzz on it. So turn the fuzz on as well and it is disgusting.
Even guitar players that aren't a fan of octave fuzzes, plug them in and they will smile.
Yeah,
exactly. They will play stuff they've never played before in the most creative, wonderful way.
Exactly.
It will just make them smile.
It's almost like, you know, when you plug into a Mesa dual rectifier and you let an open drop D chord ring and it does this shh.
Yeah, yeah.
this swooshing thing. You get the same kind of thing from fuzz if it's the right one. Mm-hmm. And it's just really cool because all these like interlocking harmonics happen that you don't get with regular overdrive or distortion. And it took me a while to appreciate fuzz because I used to hate fuzz. Mm-hmm. And then on this record, I was like, let me just try a couple. And I tried and was like, ah, I just write differently with it.
Fuzz is a hard thing to incorporate when you're trying to incorporate it.
Yes.
It always, it just kind of falls into place.
It does,
with
yeah.
With fuzzes and whatnot. Yeah. I'm guessing with the kind of music that Monuments play, it's not really a, I'm gonna get a fuzz face into a Jubilee and crank it with a Strat or something. And that's stereotypically where you find fuzzes and whatnot.
It's funny, I used to have a Jubilee.
Yeah?
And I loved it.
With a fuzz face and a Jimi Hendrix Strat playing Monument stuff?
I would, in fact, actually, I've seen Leprous playing with a Strat recently. I'm like, I should probably play a Strat.
Yeah, it's on soundcheck with a Strat. It sounded shit.
Yeah, it sounded great. I mean, it sounds amazing, but also he's having noise problems because of single coils.
It happens.
So that's kind of why I'm still on the humbuckers, you know?
Yeah, great sound on humbuckers, man. So you got the power amp, the Mesa power amps, going to actual cabs.
Actual
which
cabs.
Which is something else, which is awesome. There's no Palmer or two notes, impulse responses and stuff. It's actual cabs and whatnot.
I have a two notes cap to X in my drawer in case something happens.
Yeah.
We were going to move to them because Andy, our vocalist, was like, oh, your cabs are in my vocal mic and it's really loud and because he compresses his voice so much. So to counteract that, I've turned the cabs backwards.
Yeah.
So it's not in his in ears anymore. But I
which is a shame not turn around and seeing the Mesa Boogie logo on some cabs when you turn around.
I know it's really annoying because 4x12 Mesa Boogies do look f-ing great.
Awesome.
But about a week before this tour, the Leprous crew were like, you're not bringing any cabs, are you? I'm like, don't bring any cabs. Can you go direct, please? And I was like, no.
I mean, the two notes, I use the two notes Captor X nearly every day of my life. They're
great.
Fantastic things. Yeah. But again, coming to see Monuments Live, the fact you've got amps and cabs and stuff is just absolutely
it's just,
awesome.
It's, I can't sort of explain what it is. It's the excitement of the mic'd amp and cab.
Yeah.
And it isn't recreated yet. There's something that isn't there, and I can't say what it. Maybe it's the sound of the room.
Yeah.
Because obviously, when you put a mic in front of a cab, it's not you're not just picking up the speaker in the cab. You're picking up the room that it's in. So, when I'm standing, like say my cab's here, and I'm here in this particular room, it's going to sound different than when I'm at home.
Yeah.
And that's kind of exciting, you know. Mm-hmm. Unlike you know getting the same tone day in day out.
Yeah.
That's not exciting.
It's got to be exciting on stage. That's a great way of putting it because. One of the benefits of the modelers and stuff is you get consistent sound every night. And when it's in the mix, the crowd don't care if you're using this or that. They just want to hear the guitar tone.
Exactly.
But it needs to go back to the guitar player. The whole point is having that fun on stage
having
and feel the dynamics and stuff.
Exactly,
and
yeah. I want to have fun. I don't want to be a hospital.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? It's like every single day it sounds different. I'm just like, I'm cool with that because it's a new experience every day.
The way it's supposed to be.
Yeah,
and
exactly.
Everything's controlled by MIDI as well.
Everything's controlled by MIDI. Yeah,
so you haven't got to worry about tap dancing on stage and doing all that kind of stuff.
Nope. No, it's all done by MIDI and programmed by our drummer, Mike. Thanks, Mike, because I would not be bothered to do it.
When did your relationship with Schecter kind of come about and start?
It kind of started about 2.5 years ago. So I run a teaching website called RIFF MACHINE.
Yes.
And
a fantastic podcast, I've got to say right now.
Yeah.
I'll link everything in the description box down below so you can check that out. It's mint.
Podcast, website, you know, we do courses and stuff like that. So you can get better at rhythm guitar because no one really focuses on that. They want to shred as fast as possible like I did.
Hey man, working in a music store, I see people shred all the time when it comes to holding down some solid rhythm. It's a struggle these days for some kids.
Isn't it? Yeah, I mean, I understand it. This is like, you know, doing stuff like
it's
that.
It's way more fun.
Yeah. Way more fun. But then when you get good at rhythm and you can play that riff solid, that's equally as fun.
So you heard it from the best. Focus on your riffs and listen to it.
I mean, even the lead has rhythm, right?
For sure, yeah.
So, yeah.
Anyway, the guitar.
So we started working with Schecter at Riff Hard, where we give away a guitar a month.
Cool.
For the King of the Riff winners, which is a competition, a songwriting competition that we run every single month. Different brief, you write to it, and then you go into a, you know, I vote for a top 10.
Yeah.
And then the community votes for the who should win, based on if they follow the brief or if their track's good.
Awesome.
So that's when we started working with Schecter, and he just mailed me one day and he's like, hey.
This is Adam.
Yeah, this
he's
is
a good
Adam.
Guy, Adam. Let's shout out to Adam. Adam Murphy's a good guy.
Yeah, Adam Murphy's a great dude. So yeah, he's reached out. He's like, hey, would you be interested in, you know, a guitar? I mean, we can send you whatever you want. I was like, is it?
really, Adam?
Really? So then I reached out to him and it was like, yeah, are you would you be interested in a signature? And the reason why that happened was because Schaller discontinued the Hannes bridge.
Mm-hmm.
Quite possibly the best bridge ever made for a fixed bridge. It feels like you're playing a Floyd Rose, but you don't have all the problems.
There's a lot of length to it, isn't there? Yeah, and it kind of
it's just how it feels against the hand. You don't feel any of it. It's totally smooth, like a Floyd or a Low Pro Edge or something like that. But I don't like low pro edges or Floyds because it takes forever to change strings.
Yes.
So that's why I stuck to the fixed bridge. So that's kind of how it started. I was like, well, my minors was no longer going to be original. And I don't get me wrong, I think that guitar is still great and will always be great. Yeah. So I asked Schecter and was like, hey, should we do something? A little different body style. Obviously, I like the Strat style, so we stuck with that.
Yeah.
But they were up to it. And then they were like, all right, we'll prototype something. So within 2.5 months, they'd gotten me in prototype.
That's crazy.
Yeah,
Schecter's right. Such a great company.
They really are.
They know what they're doing and they do it bloody good.
The best part was it was like 99.9% good. Mm-hmm. And in that
this is Proto 1.
Proto 1, yeah. And the only thing was that this heel had 5 bolts in it.
Okay.
My OCD couldn't handle that, so we removed the one that was there. And then added some contours. So these contours weren't here. We made, you know, some changes to how this
the contour on the front's wonderful.
Like, yeah, it's cool,
awesome,
isn't it?
Contouring up top, and this top horn's kind of got a wonderful...
And it's so thin there, it's almost reminiscent of an S-Series Ibanez.
Yeah.
You know? Mm-hmm. And it's also super light. Feel how light that is.
That's crazy. I mean, that's due to the Swambash.
Yeah.
I assume, yeah. And you were saying before how bloody loud it is.
Yeah, I mean, just it's acoustically just... Even if I hit it softly, it jumps out.
Yeah.
Play some dad riffs.
Hey, I've got a whole career on dad riffs. Give me a break. So yeah, like again, you're a long-term user of Swambash.
Yep.
You like the words, so I'm guessing you were one of the first things you said was like, it needs to be a Swambash.
Yeah, I know. Like, there's loads of people that say that wood doesn't have any effect on an electric guitar tone, but even if it doesn't, it's how it feels when I'm playing it and it's against my body.
Exactly. All wood resonates in a different way.
To me, yeah. And then mahogany just doesn't resonate with me. Mm-hmm. So ash is like my go-to. I kind of like older too. Older's got quite a nice sound to it, but yeah, mahogany is a no-go, which is weird because I like the C1 out there and it's made of mahogany. And it's like, I can't.
That's got its own little uniqueness though. The kind of semi-hollow gives it.
I think it's the semi-hollow that makes it a little bit better for me. Yeah. So yeah, but yeah, ash all the time. I love the feel of the Wenge.
Yeah.
And we went for Paduk because Babinga is now obviously on the cities list. Mm-hmm. It was between Paduk and Purple Heart, and I think I preferred the Paduk because it's a bit, you know, closer to the Wenge.
I mean, the multiplier makes it super strong as well.
Exactly.
So this won't be going anywhere, no matter what kind of climate you're in or tuning or whatever.
I mean, one day I might ask Adam to do like a 15 ply or something.
How many ply can you fit in the neck here?
Probably is, you could probably just do all of it ply, you know, like
it's like
one
a skateboard
mil.
Day, yeah. Just entire
exactly. Or like, so it actually looks like plywood, you know, yeah. But yeah, I mean, I did originally, I think, ask for ebony fillets.
On the neck?
Yeah.
That's cool.
So, you know, a la Black Machine, you know? But we ended up going with Paduk, which obviously it's really stable. It's really nice. The Wenge's very oily, so you never feel like you're gonna get stuck. You know, with a gloss neck, when you sweat, it's like,
exactly, yeah, everyone knows the pain, yeah.
Yeah, I know some people like that, but not for me. Ebony fretboard, because it just, I mean, it looks cool.
I'm the same, like, I love ebony boards. Oh, why is it? Is it because of the sharp snapness? It's like, no, it's black, it's cool.
It looks cool, yeah. I mean, this one's got a brown streak to it. I mean, I don't know if you know this.
Yeah, it's still dark, yeah.
Ebony isn't actually black, it's stained.
Yeah.
You know, afterwards, if it's black, that means that, yeah, it was probably a shit piece of ebony. but this one's got a cool streak in it as well, and the other one has one too.
Unique.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. And the good news is that ebony doesn't show the dirt underneath, you know, the frets as quickly as maple.
Yeah.
So yeah, it looks fresh for a good long time. Stainless steel frets, because they sound good to me. Yeah. You know? You
go extra jumbo as well, don't you? So you really dig in.
Yes.
Extra jumbo frets, yeah.
Yeah. And then Luminlay fret markers, because obviously in the dark, it's easier to see.
Even watching Soundcheck, there's a lot of blackouts in your set. It was like, again, with the riffs you play, I'd hate to look down and go, shit.
We actually asked the light guy to leave like a front wash on.
Okay.
But sometimes they don't listen.
Yeah.
You know, so the front wash means that I can actually see what I'm doing.
Yeah.
There was actually a point in Maastricht a few days ago, I think that's how you pronounce the name, where the light guy blacked out for the acoustic part that I play by myself. And I could not see any of the fretboard because the C1
doesn't
have...
The C1 hasn't got the lumen lay.
Hasn't got lumen lay. So black dots on white. And I was like, let's hope that's the fifth fret. Yeah, so...
Oh, God.
Yeah, so it's useful for situations like that. Because as long as it gets a little bit of light during stage, then you'll at least have a little glow on it, you know?
Yeah. I mean, speaking of, like, the way it looks, the colour's wonderful.
Yeah, it's like a plum, isn't it?
It's bloody beautiful, mate. Yeah. I mean, you've known in the past with quite unique colours, like some of the juice bursts and stuff in the past are pretty crazy. What made you settle on purple and that kind of flame?
Purple's my favourite colour.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's just,
It makes a pretty guitar as well, man.
It does, doesn't it? And, you know, purple to me is like, you know, because it's blue and red mixed together, it's like the everything about it is just just cool. It's just, you know, you think purple, you think, I don't know if you've seen that BMW, they have a color called the Thunder Knight, and it is, it's really good.
Not too sure. I can say myself quite an intense car guy, but I'm not sure a Thunder Knight, yeah.
It's a BMW 2 Series, and unfortunately I don't fit in one. Unless I'm too tall or too fat, one of those. I was going to go get one and I couldn't fit in. I was so gutted because it's the only car they do Thunder Knight in. So I saw that color. I was like, yeah, Schecter, it needs to be like purple, dark, dark, dark purple. And we went with plum. And it looks very cool with obviously the black highlighting the flame.
Yeah. And contrasting with the black hardware as well. You're saying like one volume three-way switch.
Yep.
You've always rocked one volume three-way switch. Yep. You don't need a tone control, but you've got the coil tap if you want some extra extra tones, I guess.
So you can have the single coil. I do actually really like P90s.
Yeah.
But I find them too noisy in a live situation. Yeah. So maybe one day I'll work on a P90, a seven-string P90.
Yeah, that'd be sweet. It'd be so clanky and wonderful.
It's like, it's the openness of a single coil, but with the thickness of a humbucker. So it's like the best of both, you know? So that's why I like them. But they always sound really pissed off.
Yeah.
Like the P90.
I think the harder you play a P90, the better it sounds.
It definitely does.
The more vibration is happening. Yeah.
You get more girth out of it.
For sure, man. Speaking of pickups, let's talk about these pickups for a little bit. I know you've got a boost and rock to thousands of folk, but let's quickly talk about the pickups. So how did these come about and why did you spec them the way you did?
So we, so basically I've been a bare knuckle user for a very, very long time. I've been using a nail bomb, ceramic nail bomb for 15 years. In the bridge.
Great pickups.
Yep. And then the cold sweat in the neck, which again is a great pickup. But I really wanted to make changes to those pickups. That's what we did with this. I basically said to Schecter, like, because they were like, do you want a set of custom pickups or signature pickups? And I was like, yeah, I'd be interested, but I don't think there's any way you're going to be able to beat these pickups. So I sent them to them and said, like, you know, this is the sound that I want. See what you can do. So they made the Colossus based off of the nail bomb, but they actually did it off the nail bomb Alnico rather than the ceramic one, which I'm not normally a fan of.
Was that your choice or was that just them surprising you?
I think they surprised me because they used the it's an Alnico magnet in here and I normally hate Alnico, but they said that they made it with a certain amount of wine so it retained the thing that I liked about the nail bomb, which was the fact that it was slightly dry and not muddy. And I've always found Alnico magnets to be a little bit more mushy than
especially the kind of music that you
So this has got an Alnico magnet in it and it sounds pissed off.
So you just like a really pissed off guitar tone.
Basically if I'm playing, I hit it hard and I've hardly got any gain on my amp and it's screaming at me, that's what I want. But I want the mid-range to be really focused on that as well. Like I know there's not a terrible amount of mids in our music, but the mids is what creates the note. So you kind of need it.
It's all talking where the guitar sits as well.
Exactly, So I want the focus to be on the higher mids rather than the 300 to 500 that lead players like. I want the 1 to 2K that's like the hitting you in the face, you know? Almost like a screaming baby on a plane, you know?
I will say as well, if you guys want to check out Schecter's custom shop, again, linked in the description box is our awesome tour of the custom shop, Schecter's custom shop, where we'll go through all the pickup guys and talk to the guys and gals in there. It's just awesome.
So yeah, that's it. It's a very, very, very cool guitar. So if you haven't checked it out already, go check it out, see what you think. Don't take my word for it. Just try yourself.
Yeah, get yourself to your local PMT store and try it out for yourself. I will say as well, from stage to studio, this is the first tour with the TAO. Have you had it much in the studio? Because it is quite a recent thing.
It is. I've actually had this guitar for a year.
So was this on the last
album? This was on the last album. I used this one, the 7-string and the 8-string and the prototype, first prototype ones, on all the songs except Cardinal Red and Lavos. But all the other songs are these guitars.
Absolutely awesome. Yep. Well, check it out with PMT. All the links are in the description box down below. Well, I think that's your entire rig, mate. Thank you so much for taking the time.
Anytime, mate. Thank you very much for coming.
Have a great tour. It's been an absolute blast and I'll catch you next time.
Thank you very much, mate.
Cheers, guys. Thank you.
Cheers.